So before I start discussing anything about this unit, have a look at this very interesting and a funny video. So you might think that why we are looking at this video and how this video is related to what we are about to study. Look, the name of this unit is queuing theory, right? Or at some places you will also find the name to be queuing models. So the basic term, basic phrase in this whole name is a queue. Okay. Generally in India, we call it as a line. Whenever you go to a counter or anywhere where you have to make a line for the service, maybe when you are booking a ticket, maybe when you are ordering some food, so we call it a line, right? But line is not the proper term for it. The proper term for it is queue, Q-U-E-U-E. Okay, so in the video you saw that there were two different queues and there was a person who was confused between which of the queue to join. Both of these queues were being served by two person. Okay, you might not be able to see those two person in the video, but in the end two person exited from the counter, so those two were serving the other people in the queue. All right, and there was this one person who was confused whether to join this or to join the other. So what were the common things present in such a model, in such a system? There were more than one queues. Okay, there were some people who were serving the people in the queue. So the people in the queue were being served by someone. Okay. The speed with which they were serving was changing. Sometimes one queue was moving faster, sometimes other queue was moving faster. And a person was constantly shifting from one queue to the other. Right? These were some of the things that we observed from that funny video clip. Now, how is this going to be relevant for us? Look. In this unit, what we are going to study is the mathematical behavior of queues. How queues behave mathematically as a mathematical entity. You have to look at queue not just as a collection of people, as a bunch of people standing one after the other, but look at the queue from mathematical point of view. Consider it like a mathematical entity whose length is increasing and decreasing. And the rate at which it is increasing is different. The rate at which it is decreasing is also different. And when there are more than one queues, then you can also compare these mathematical entities with each other. Their length you can compare. The time in which they're, they are getting finished. The time in which these queues are getting zero, that you can compare. The speed with which they are getting increased or decreased, that you can compare. So basically for this unit, you need to look at these queues from mathematical point of view as if they are some mathematical entity. Their mathematical behavior we need to understand. Okay. And not only their mathematical behavior, but as a result of that, what other parameters come into action? Whenever someone is standing in a queue, whenever someone is entering into this mathematical model, you can say, then what other factors come into picture, those we will also consider here. And don't think that this particular queuing theory or queuing model unit is irrelevant from practical point of view. You may think that why as an engineer you are supposed to study about queues, okay? You are not going to be at such a place where you have to, you know, count the number of people in the queue or things like that. You might not be able to relate it, but in queues it is not necessary that only people will be there. In queues there can be products as well. Some products waiting to go to a machining center, to getting serviced, to getting machined, right? Consider this thing from industrial point of view, where there is a big industry, there are different machines, different assembly lines in which products are moving, just like people are moving, right? And just like people were getting served, those products will also get served at different machining center, at different machining heads. And then even after finalizing, when the product is ready, then again in packaging and distributing everywhere, this thing is going to be coming into the picture, right? So I hope you got an idea of how this queuing theory or queuing model unit is going to be very relevant in different industries when mass production is going on and different products are moving in different lines, either for machining, for their manufacturing, or for packaging or ordering or for delivering. All right. So this unit is again important from practical point of view. From the point of view of gate also, it is pretty much decent. Okay. It's not very important, or it is not very less important. It is moderately important. Again, I am telling you that the units in general, what we are covering in industrial engineering and operational research, they are going to be very scoring, and there is not going to be highly conceptual or innovative question, because the syllabus is defined and what is expected from you as an undergraduate, that is also defined. So again, this unit is very simple, very easy, and very scoring. All right. So let's start the discussion about queues. And the very first thing that you need to understand in queues is that whatever queuing system you have, wherever a queue is being made and queue is being served, there are three basic behaviors. First behavior is arrival in a queue. You have a queue, so people arrive in a queue. This is a basic behavior, right? Second behavior is that after arriving in the queue and after waiting for their turn, they are getting serviced. There is a counter. Obviously, there is a counter for which the queue is there. Maybe that counter may be having a person or may not be having a person. Maybe it's a ATM machine. So that is also a server, right? That is also a place where people are getting serviced. They make a queue and one by one they are getting serviced. So arrival, then service happens at the station, at the server, and then they depart from the queue. They leave from the queue. So arrival, service, and departure. These are the three basic elements of any queue, and there is some mathematical pattern into this that we obviously have to study. Now, you may think that how can we study such a random thing? Arriving in a queue, and you can say that, okay, servicing maybe have some mathematical mathematical connection, how much time it is taking and how fast it can service depending upon the people or the machine. But you may think that arrival, how is it even a mathematical thing? Anyone can arrive anytime, but it's not like that. Recall what I told you in the last unit. Even random data like height, marks, blood pressure, it's such a random thing. That also follows a normal distribution, right? So you may think that something as a layman may look very random to you. But when you observe it mathematically, there will be some pattern, there will be some distribution. Normal distribution, beta distribution, different types of distributions are there. So there will be some mathematical pattern that you can figure out, and on the basis of that, you can study that behavior. All right. So let's start this unit. So as I mentioned before, the place where the queue is getting serviced is called as a server. Okay. Where maybe people may be standing in a queue to withdraw money from the ATM. So ATM is the server. People may be standing in a queue to order their food. So the person standing at the food counter doing the billing, that is the part of server. Maybe they might be going, to some garage to get their cars serviced, to get their cars washed. So that place where the car is getting washed and serviced, that is the server. So basically the place where ultimately the queue, the member of the queue are getting the service for which they were waiting is called as a server. Alright, the server can be a single one or there can be multiple servers also. For example, in the video that we saw, there were two servers, right? But there can be more than two servers as well. This is the example of server 1, server 2 and server 3. This is the top view, let's say, and these are the people who are standing in a queue. You might have seen different queues, more than one queues in banks or in railway stations or in or at airports. So this is the example of multi-server or multiple server queue. Multiple server queue, right? There are more than one server. Similarly, there can be a single server queue as well. Single server queue as well. For example, if there is a place where a single ATM machine is there, so only one queue can form there, right? So that's only one server is there basically. In India, you can form three queues for a single server, which is not an ideal situation. But generally, if you have a single server, the single queue will be formed. So basically, when you have a single server, so for that server, there will be a queue. There will be people in the queue who are waiting for the service, right? And they approach the server, they get served, and after getting the service, they get happy and then they leave, right? So this is a single server queue system. This is a multiple server queue system. Multiple server queue system. Now, whoever is joining the queue, there can be some situations where there are definite number of people who can join the queue. Okay. In some cases, there can be such situations where not, the number of people or the number of, the number of members of the queue can be limited or they can be unlimited. That is called as queue length. That how many people or how many members in flow, I may call it as a people, but it's not necessary that only people are joining the queue. They can be, as I told you, objects also, machines also. They can be any living or non-living thing in the queue. Okay, so what I was telling you is that in different systems or for different queuing models, there can be some situations where only limited number of objects or people or member can join the queue, or there can be a situation where theoretically infinite people can join the queue. For example, if you have a station, a garage station, okay, you have a garage where cars are coming, they are getting washed, they are getting serviced, and then they leave. And in the garage, there are only 10 slots to park the car. Whoever is bringing their car, there are only 10 slots there. What will happen? The length of queue has been restricted. Only 10 cars can be there in the in the system to get served in the queue, one after the other. If the 11th car comes, when all the slots are filled, what will happen? That car, either it cannot join the system or it will have to leave the system. Correct? Don't think that it will stand just outside of the slots and you will call this also as a queue. Okay, we are again talking about a very organized system. Don't consider it any garage next door in our country where you can form any number of queues and you can break the queue and you can just make the chaos of a queue. Don't consider those situations. Consider it to be an organized situation where if there are 10 slots, so only 10 cars can be parked. If 11th car comes, either it will stay out of the system or it will have to leave the system, right? So in such a case, the queue length is finite. Only 10 members, 10 cars or 10 people can join the queue. So such a system is called as a finite queue system. Finite queue system. Correct? But there can be other systems where the queue can be theoretically infinite. For example, in any religious place, in any temple, let's say, in any bank, let's say, for any ATM machine, theoretically it can be infinite. Any number of people can join the queue. There is no restriction of how many people can join it, right? The queues can extend out of the boundaries of that particular bank or that particular temple as well, right? The queues are sometimes extended way long. I have seen them at some places. So practically the length of those queues are not finite they are not limited people who can join the queue. Any number of people can join that queue. So such queue system is called as infinite queue system. In generally, the type of system that we will study generally is going to be infinite queue system, where there can be, where there is no limit on how much is the, how much the length of queue is. All right. The next thing about queue is who can join the queue. If you have a population of a lot of people, then who among those can join the queue? Again, I'm telling you, don't think that I'm only talking about people. When I'm saying that we have a lot of population, it does not mean that I'm only talking about the people. I can also talk about the machine or any object or any non-living thing here. Okay. So depending upon who can join the queue, or what, you know, what members of the population, of any living or non-living population, can join the queue, you can further have two categorization, and that is infinite population model and finite population model. Look, in infinite population model, basically anyone can join the queue. Generally, the queue at doctors, the queue at reservation centers, at booking counters, at food stalls, anyone and everyone is free to join the queue, correct? That's an example of infinite population model. Again, don't confuse between these two. This tells the number of people who can join the queue, right? But this tells the type of people who can join the queue. In infinite population model, only means not only, any type of person can join the queue, correct? But if I talk about finite population model, then there are only certain people who can join the queue. For example, if you have been to an airport, you will see that there is a different line, you can say, for you know, for the business class people, or for any privileged person who is, you know, who is a member of that particular airline. Similarly, there can be some queue dedicatedly for you know, for women. Or if I leave aside the people and I come to the example of non-living thing, then suppose you have a factory, okay, and in that factory there is a maintenance office, where whatever parts of a machine in that factory are not working properly, so they can come at the maintenance office to get it repaired. And in that factory, let's say there are 30 machines. So for that server, for that maintenance server, the population is finite. It is not going to service any random machine coming from anywhere. Even within the factory also, you cannot call the maintenance office to fix the fan or to fix the light, right? There is a definite type of machine that they are going to service, that is going to get served. And those machines are present within the factory. Not any machine can randomly come for the service. So that is an example of finite population model. So there were three categorization which we discussed here. The first was the categorization of server, single server or multiple server. Second was the categorization on the basis of number of members in the queue, whether that number is fixed, finite, or it can theoretically be infinite. And third was the type of member in the queue, whether the type of member in the queue can be any given member that belongs to infinite population, or they were a definite set of people or definite set of objects that can join the queue. So these were the three categorization. Theoretical questions can be asked from this. The general type of discussion or general type of queuing system that we will study will be having infinite queue system, or infinite queue length also you can call them, system or length. So infinite queue length system with infinite population model. So these are the general types of systems that we study in our discussion of this unit. All right.